BBC Archive Voices, Brian Clough. Sport 2. Broadcast on BBC Two, 11th of August, 1972.
Of course, you're now in the situation where you've got half the public hating you and half the public just hanging on your next pronouncement. Would you accept that's a rather average ratio of how people...
No, I wouldn't, no. It's three quarters hating and a quarter hanging on the words. No, it's changed a little bit since we've won the league championship, actually. What happened was everybody, or most people, used to watch television, and they weren't interested in what you said, the content of it. They were just interested in how you said it. And if you said it nastily, or if you happened to be a little bit aggressive, then the content was scrubbed out, and everybody said, this man's crackers. Now, of course, having won a First Division championship, they turn around and say, well, we better listen to him next time, because he just doesn't shout because he's won the championship as well. And he might just be saying something worth listening to.
Naturally, though, as blunt as you appear on television. Is that the real Brian Clough? You know, the man who jumps and snaps on people and cuts their sentences off?
Snaps and jumps, I'm afraid, yes. I don't like to admit to this type of thing because it's a terrible indictment against me. But the shouting and the snapping is there in everyday life. It's a man with opinions, you know, Ian, that you're talking about. It's the man who hasn't got opinions that doesn't shout and doesn't do anything, you know. The quiet, silent type, hell's fire. I didn't know these type of people existed, you know, except people who've got nothing to say.
Everything's going for you now, but can you afford to be as blunt as that, say, when you're losing, if you had two or three bad seasons?
If we get bad notices or have a bad time for 3 years, as you've suggested, then I might get a little bit nastier with people.
You think that's possible?
Oh, I'm sure it is, yes. Because then people would get a little bit nastier with me. There's always a section of people in any profession waiting around for somebody to fall off a so-called pedestal.
But who are these people who are waiting?
Well, I would say the people who are envious of Derby County winning a championship. I would say they're the people who are envious of me personally, you know, a 36-year-old having got the one thing that, you know, you're supposed to strive 25 years for.
What sort of home did you come from?
A very happy home, working class, a large family, five brothers, two sisters. Got great childhood memories, not of riding horses or on yachts and things like that, but great memories of happiness in parks and playing football. Academically, not very bright, a bit of a letdown in the family I was. Everybody else made it to the grammar school, a long run of success, and then I come along and fail. It's a bit of a letdown for everybody, but mainly for me. I did the crying, nobody else.
Brian, what were your earliest ambitions away from football?
I got visions of putting the world right at the early doors, 20-year-old, when I was wasting my time doing national service, all that type of thing. And then I thought, well, of course, to try and do this, you've got to get into politics. That was very evident in my early thoughts. It's been evident right throughout, you know, the time I've been in football, never mind early doors.
You've used this phrase, early doors, a couple of times. What does that mean?
Well, it's just a phrase meaning getting in first, I suppose. I think it originated from if you went to the pictures early, you could get in cheaper than if you went 10 minutes later. But of course we use it at Derby County in the sense of get in early doors, get in before everybody else wakes up, sign players while they're thinking about it, stick a goal in before they get settled down. That type of thing it's used for to express things in football.
That's really your philosophy.
Well, of course. Get in first.
Brian, what do you see in a football match which no one else sees? In other words, the factor that makes you an exceptional manager.
I don't know what to see in other matches. I know what to see in our in the matches we take part in. I see absolute dedication. I see strain to an unbelievable state where players are emotionally drained completely, and that I would like to show the whole football world, directors, football league officials, referees, everybody connected with the game, journalists, the face of a Derby County footballer having been beaten. That's what I would like to imprint and say, well, look, this is what it feels like. Now, the next time you delve into football, delve into it with a little bit of heart.
But surely tactically, which is the basis of the game, tactics being the basis of the game, you can see something which journalists and spectators who come and pay at the gate simply can't see. What is it?
You just recognise the talent of an individual player and then put it all together. If you recognise it before anybody else and you get a player very cheap, like we happen to get a few of ours, you mould it together.
Best third best header of the ball in the club. I can see no point in you taking corners. I'd much prefer you sticking it in. First of all, I think we've got more skillful players than you to take corners. And secondly, you're one of the best in the club. Get in there. That's what I pay you for.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.